Okay, we will go ahead and get started. It's a couple minutes after. So I'm Victoria Henley. I'm going to be leading the trip to England, spring break 2022. The trip does have a Harry Potter focus, but we're going to see all sorts of other sites as well. So you don't have to be a Harry Potter fan. Hopefully you will be by the end, but that's just a personal thing. So Eric Hill is joining us for the first part of this call, and he'll introduce himself.
Hi, I'm Eric. I teach in the English area here at Davidson, and I'm really glad everybody's here to learn more about this wonderful trip to England. I hope everybody, well, I guess not everybody can join us, but I hope as many people as possible can. So, take it away.
So I should mention, I'm an advisor here at the college. I work with high school students. So I recognize some names here, and I'm sure I'll be talking about this to all my advisees. So if anyone is watching the recording here, you know, feel free to reach out, and I'll go ahead and share my screen and get started. So I studied abroad in England when I was in college. This is part of why I chose this location for my first time as an official leader of one of these trips. I have co-led some study abroad experiences, and I've traveled abroad in many of these like short-term kind of trips as well, but this will be my first time actually leading the trip. And so I wanted to choose a place where I had spent a lot of time. So I was there for a full semester in college and right in London. So we'll spend a lot of time in London. We'll also travel to some surrounding cities. I'll kind of talk you through the itinerary here in a minute. And then I also chose Harry Potter just because it's something that's specific to my childhood. I grew up with those books and those movies. And I thought it would be a cool thing to be able to see some of the filming locations. And I also, you know, figured that maybe some other people might find that experience kind of interesting as well. So quick overview of the itinerary. Day one is depart for England. Day two, an orientation in London. Day three, kind of a walking tour. Might, you know, be on a bus for a little while, but basically just walking around London and seeing some sights. That will include some Harry Potter filming locations, but it will also include, some major tourist destinations in London. Day four, same kind of deal. There is a lot to see in London. I mean, you know, definitely you could spend months and months and months there and still not see everything there is to see. So we'll make do with what we can in 2 days. Day five is the Warner Brothers studio tour. So this will take you behind the scenes of Harry Potter and get to see some of that movie magic. So within London and Oxford and some of these towns that we're going to go to, we'll see where the filming the film crew would go actually on site to film. And then the Warner Brothers studio tour is, you know, going to be basically the world that's created within this structure, this building. So it's entirely Harry Potter in there. Day six is Ashridge Estate and traveling to Oxford. I'll talk a little bit more about Ashridge Estate in a minute. Day seven is Lacock sites. So Lacock is a town that has sort of been preserved in its time, and it's kind of an interesting phenomenon. I'll talk about that in a minute also. And day eight, Oxford, and day nine, depart for home. The quick, you know, bullet points, what's great about this program, the reason why I wanted to the way I designed this and thought it through is that I wanted to spend as much time on the ground as possible. What I mean by that is, you know, these short-term trips can often take you from one country to another, maybe even three countries in a week. And so you're only spending like a day in a country, and then you're spending, you know, 5 or 6 hours on a train or a bus or a ferry, maybe even a plane. So I wanted to spend as little time as possible traveling and as much time as possible actually seeing sights and, encountering that culture, not just through a window of a bus. The tour is specialized, so you'll see things outside of the normal tourist destinations. Again, we will definitely hit some highlights in London and Oxford, but I really wanted to kind of go a little bit off the beaten path, and I think making this a Harry Potter themed tour kind of will do that. So we'll go down some side streets to see random filming locations that you might not have otherwise taken those roads in just a normal tour. And the price is also a really big benefit. So the company that we're going with works really hard to find ways to cut corners and without sacrificing quality. So it's going to be around $3,000. I know this might seem like a lot, but it's actually very reasonable for everything that's included. And I'll talk a little bit more about what's included in the program fee a little bit later. So getting into some of the sites, you know, this is kind of a prime example of something we might see that has to do with Harry Potter. So the picture on the left is what the location actually looks like. The picture on the right is a mock-up of what the Leaky Cauldron looks like in the Harry Potter movies. So on the left, that shop is actually a flower shop, and it's turned into kind of a pub that represents the entry into the magical world. So, you know, I wanted to take a second here to talk about British pub culture. So, I think this is something interesting that, you know, the reason why J.K. Rowling chose this pub as a place where people enter from the Muggle world into the magical world, and then, you know, why a pub? This website is kind of interesting. 7 differences between American and British pubs, if you wanted to take a look at it later. They talk about how Brits occupy pubs in the same way that Americans occupy coffee shops. So there's no kind of shame in going into the pub at, you know, 2 in the afternoon for a beer, because it's maybe just a place they want to sit and read or work on homework or you know, chat with friends like we would with coffee shops. So, you know, you might compare pubs in England or the UK to bars in the United States, and bars for us are, you know, a little bit more focused on the drinking, or maybe, you know, watching sports if it's a sports bar, or even, you know, dancing if it's a little bit more of a clubby kind of place. But the pub's a little bit more of a cozy, relaxed, you know, think about lots of wooden beams and, you know, comfy chairs and, you know, the kind of a rich environment to kind of relax in. And then British pubs take their charm from the old buildings in which they're housed. So, you know, obviously the history in the UK, you know, you can see it go way back farther than you can in the United States. There's, you know, the buildings themselves are older, you know, so that charm kind of comes from the history that that the UK has that, you know, the United States just kind of doesn't. So at least not, you know, with structural kind of buildings. So you know, they kind of get that there. And this is something that I think, you know, Harry Potter kind of pulls into it. You can sort of see that and throughout, and you can see that in the Leaky Cauldron. And then the last thing here that I think is kind of interesting as a way to bring pubs into Harry Potter is that the names themselves of the pubs are kind of characteristic. So the Drunken Duck and the Swan with Two Necks, you know, the Leaky Cauldron is another example of that. And it kind of gives you this feeling of magic just in the name, you know, more than maybe even a place to gather and drink. It's something out of a fairy tale. So kind of jumping over to the, you know, the more touristy side of London, you know, some of the main things we're going to see of those, one of my favorite places is the Tower of London. You know, if you think about the period of time in London where people were getting beheaded left and right, this is kind of the go-to spot for that. It's also famous as the place where the crown jewels are held. So you can see these like really exquisite and fancy crowns and, you know, kind of feel a little bit royal walking through there and seeing how those were constructed and the just the richness of that. This castle was built during the reign of William the Conqueror after his successful Norman invasion of 1066. Over the coming centuries, walls were added. It was built up into the imposing fortress we see today. And some famous people who are associated with this this structure, Guy Fawkes, Anne Boleyn, Sir Walter Raleigh, they were all in those jail cells there. So, you know, one of the really cool things about the Tower of London, it's known for its tour guides. So, you know, I'm sure when we tour it, we'll have somebody, you know, they always dress up and play the part really well. And so that's always kind of a fun thing to get somebody who's really good at their job telling you about all this cool stuff. All right, jumping back into Harry Potter. And, you know, honestly, this is a little bit how the trip will feel. I mean, we're going to kind of intersperse Harry Potter with, you know, traditional London sites, you know, so you'll get a little bit of each kind of along the way, and hopefully it'll keep things interesting. So we will see the Warner Brothers Harry Potter studio. You know, this is one picture from it of Diagon Alley. You can see the Weasleys. Wizard Weezes there, the shop that they've created. So I imagine this is going to feel like you're stepping into the movie. This is honestly one thing I'm really, really excited to see. I wasn't thinking we were going to be able to fit this into the tour because I was expecting it to raise the price so much. But again, the program that we're working with has managed to get it in there and keep the price low for us. All right, jumping back to Ashridge Estate. This has a slight connection with Harry Potter because this is where the Whomping Willow tree lived. Unfortunately, the tree has passed away, and I guess it was a really, really old tree. And, you know, I don't think it was harmed in the making of the movie, but yeah, it has since passed on. So just a little bit of a history about this place. The history of these grounds go back to ancient history, so there are ancient monuments located around the estate. It became a monastery for a while where the Blue Friar monks lived. And then Henry VIII owned it for a while. And from then, a series of famous and/or rich people kind of took ownership. It was passed down sort of through family members and extended family members for a long time. And then by World War I and World War II, the landscape of this place really started to change. It became a place where soldiers were trained and housed, and it was also a hospital in World War II. It's now owned by the National Trust, which is Europe's largest conservation charity. The National Trust is this organization that, you know, one of their focuses is restoring places like this and kind of turning them into you know, functional locations. So, you know, in this case, it is a business school and it's also obviously a tourist attraction. So, so again, this is something that is kind of off the beaten path. This is a tourist attraction, but it's not something that, you know, most whirlwind kind of tours, you know, or study abroad programs would necessarily take you to. So this is kind of a unique opportunity. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the history of estates in England. They've got a really interesting backstory. And if you think about Downton Abbey, that show kind of goes over a lot of those interesting sort of phenomenons that happen with these estates. And it's, you know, there's a lot that a lot of history here, not just in this estate, but across the UK, really. So when you think of grand country mansions and estates, you can kind of picture something from what you're probably picturing is something from 17th to 19th century, England, Scotland, Ireland, and Wales. With all of these, you know, mansions and castles and fortresses and palaces, all these places across the UK, you know, it definitely makes sense that J.K. Rowling would picture Hogwarts Castle, and you know, this is the backdrop for, you know, for this magic school, and you know, for the filming, it was probably easy enough to find lots of interior shots, and we'll see some of those shots. Little bit about these different structures. Castles is kind of what started the whole process of manors. Castles were sort of a one-stop shop. So you had people living inside the walls of the castle. You know, there, it was a home for many people. It was also a place to store ammunition. And then it also offered, or, you know, was a place that would be protected from, from invasions. And then once castles sort of started to not be as popular, fortresses were sort of focused versions of castles. So the main goal of the fortress was to not let people in and to act as a place where, people could use as for wartime. Palaces, the Cribs, like that show Cribs. I might be dating myself a little bit with that. I'm not sure if everyone knows that what that show is anymore, but it's the super old version of that show, the UK edition. So the whole point of palaces is to make a statement, like, we have all the money, we can do whatever we want with it. So we're just gonna make a room full of mirrors. We're gonna make this incredibly expensive garden that's ridiculously hard to upkeep. We're gonna do all the gold, all the ceiling paintings that we can. So really, they're statement pieces. Manors are still meant to be a statement, make this statement, I have money. But they're a little bit more, I'd say, muted. So if you kind of think about like a manor versus a palace, a manor might look a little bit more like a castle than a palace would. And then I want to talk a little bit more about manors, because I think they have kind of like just this really interesting history. So, landlords would own the manors, and they would also own huge amounts of land surrounding the manors, or they would, own this land and build this manor on the land. And so this land was passed down by law through male heirs. And so it stayed in the family, and they would earn money on top of that by charging rent to tenants all over the land. And, the idea with the manors is that money is no object. So we can build on, we can do incredible gardens, we can do all this kind of stuff. And it's no skin off our back. So that sort of model was not sustainable. And it started to sort of crumble around the Industrial Revolution, when people who were tenants of those landlords realized that they could go make money in the cities and not just have to farm. So they could basically have this hopefully better life making money that way. And then, moving forward a little bit in history from there, the cost of the upkeep just continued to be a problem for the landlords. So they had to pay for servants, they had to pay for repairs, they had to pay for landscaping. And as these tenants kept kind of moving away, that, the funding for those expenses started to dwindle. And then by World War II and World War I and World War II, especially, things really took a turn. So servants were tired of working, really long hours and, kind of living this lifestyle there. So they started to enlist, and then heirs of the landlords also started to enlist. So, this law that says it has to be passed down to the male heir started to create a problem because the heirs were enlisting. And then World War II, London and surrounding areas being bombed, rationing was part of that, evacuations to other countries. Funding just became a major issue. So what ends up happening eventually is the landlords would start to sell off their land bit by bit, eventually realizing that they can't keep up with the mansion or the estate at all. And so so either they fall into disrepair, or they, sometimes in some cases would just, take them to the ground and just have the land without the manor. So National Trust, that organization, that's where they would step in and potentially restore, those manors that had gone into disrepair, and create, a functional space again, and somewhere that we can hopefully visit. So Blackhawk, England is this village that I talked about we're gonna get to visit. It is a place that has sort of been preserved in time. So they haven't added telephone cables or, wires or, signs that indicate that we're in the 21st century. They've really tried to keep it looking sort of medieval. So this is actually a place that lots of film crews go, not just for Harry Potter, but this is a popular filming location, which is interesting because they're trying so hard to keep it preserved in its time. And yet, I would imagine there's regular interference of that with these camera crews. I mean, you can look at the picture on the left, I'm sure is kind of what they're going for. They want people to see it as this, ideal picturesque kind of place. And then you see the picture on the right where they've got this big crane and, film crews walking around and stuff. So, those are the kind of things we'll talk about on this trip and in the class that you have to take leading up to the trip, just talking through some of the pros and cons of, what movies like Harry Potter do to the UK and other areas, and what movies in general, what pop culture kind of does to the landscape of a country when they get to be so popular that they're sort of, arguably kind of invading the residence space. Blackrock Abbey, this is kind of one of the main tourist destinations for this little town. And, this is also a filming location for Harry Potter. You can see there, Harry with the mirror, in that kind of picturesque location. Again, I mean, there's just tons of these options for the filming crew to go in and, get that feel that they're going for. In this case, it's a abbey that was founded in the 13th century by Augustinian nuns. This is used for several scenes in the Harry Potter films. Next, we will travel to Oxford. So this town is one of my favorite places in the UK. It's got kind of a small town vibe, but there is still plenty to do. It's also kind of definitely got that college vibe, sitting in pubs. I remember sitting in a pub where J.R.R. Tolkien and his crew would kind of get together. It's called the Eagle and Child. And I remember overhearing some college students talking about their homework. Of course, this is Oxford, so it's like, one of the academic centers of the world. And, so they're talking in really big words that you can barely understand, but it was such a fun thing to overhear. So it was settled by Anglo-Saxons in 900, and it was, in Old English, it was known as Oxen of Forta, or Fort of the Oxen. And over the years, it grew into an important religious and academic center. This university is one of the oldest in the English-speaking world and has some of the oldest churches. So, again, that old sort of castle-y, manor-y, fortress-y kind of vibe, that's something that really played well into the Harry Potter movies and is why Oxford was also a filming location for Harry Potter. So the Bodleian Library, one of the most famous libraries in the world, is also the Hogwarts Library. So you can see there the restricted section. I think the movie magic is probably pretty strong in these scenes. So, you'll see some things that, might kind of look familiar, but kind of keep in mind when we're in these places, a lot of it is the movie magic that turns into Hogwarts. So I mentioned that we're gonna have this class that you have to take before we actually travel. That class is HUM 180, and you can take it as a continuing education class, which is kind of just like for fun, or you can take it as a curriculum class. And so if you still need a humanities requirement to graduate, then this can substitute in for that requirement. It's just something to think about and not something you have to decide on right away, but maybe a discussion with your advisor. And I should have mentioned at the start, these study abroad programs are open to students, of course, but they're also open to, community members, faculty, staff, anyone who's interested basically can go. And so, if you're not a student here, then it kind of makes sense to take the class as a continuing education, just for fun kind of class. So in that class, we will be talking about how to think critically about popular culture. And so we will, obviously talk about Harry Potter, but we're going to kind of think a little bit more broadly about it too. Some of the blockbuster hits that are out there, where were they filmed? And did that impact the tourism in that area? So how has Harry Potter affected tourism in England? We'll ask questions like, how do movies change the way we read our favorite books? So, you know, if you grew up with Harry Potter, like I did, reading the books and then watch the movies and then go back and read the books, you know, all of a sudden you start to picture those characters and those sets from the movies, rather than maybe how you initially read the books or pictured those characters. So, you know, there's just kind of some interesting questions that are brought up by how, you know, how movies, and especially movies that become really, really famous, end up changing the original material. We'll talk about fan culture. So, you know, I'm not sure if you all are familiar, but there's a Pottermore website. You know, this is a place where you can get sorted into the different houses. So you can find out if you're a Gryffindor or a Slytherin or a Hufflepuff or Ravenclaw. There are fan fiction stories out there that kind of delve into different ideas about what might happen after the story's over, or even, you know, within the stories themselves, you know, little side stories that might happen that are plausible. And so, you know, well, and then, you know, things like the Harry Potter theme park, you know, all these things exist because fans want to keep experiencing this world. So, you know, we can talk about, is that good? Is that bad? Is it somewhere in between? You know, I feel like, you know, there's all kinds of pros and cons to something like this blowing up to the proportion that it has. So I know I've talked a lot about Harry Potter, but England really is for everyone. This is a fantastic place to travel for the first time if you've never been out of the country. You know, there's a lot of connection between the UK and the US. You know, the relationship is a solid one, and it's you know, obviously that, you know, the English language is a kind of main example of that, but it extends beyond that. So, you know, it's somewhere that you're not going to have a ton of culture shock or anything to really throw you off too much. And, you know, we will definitely, in that HUM 180 class, we will definitely talk through what is different. And, you know, things like the pub culture, that is something that, you know, is really fun to see for the first time, but it's different. You know, you're not going to experience everything the same way that you would here. So, you know, things like, you know, people drinking more tea than coffee. I mean, you know, you might already drink a lot of tea, but, and so that may be something that for you, you really connect with British culture over the tea. You know, the people there, I've grown to love, you know, the people, and, you know, hope that we'll get to have some really solid experiences interacting with people there. You know, that is kind of one of the challenges of these short-term trips, is trying to interact as much as possible with the people, because that is the way to really get to know a culture best. We'll try to visit some art museums if possible. You know, we'll talk about the history of literature and theater and architecture. There's all kinds of things to explore during our class. And then, you know, hopefully we'll have a little bit of time to get into some of that stuff when we're actually there. You know, occasionally we'll have some free time. So if, you know, if there are things that you look up that you really want to do, like if you're really into modern art, you know, there's an awesome modern art museum right in London. You know, that might be something that you can spend a little time doing. There's some really cool military history things in London. You know, there's some ways that you can kind of get that in, even if, you know, even if it's not necessarily on the schedule. One thing that's particularly fun for me when I go to cities abroad, the markets. So, you know, if you think about a farmer's market here, it's kind of similar to that, but they're open like all the time rather than like just on Sundays or Saturdays or something. And they have all kinds of handmade goods and, you know, spices and herbs and foods, and just they're a really fun way to kind of see that culture. Okay, so I've been talking for a while. I want to get you guys involved a little bit if you can. So if you'll use the chat box, I want to know how well you know British TV. So these are shows that all of these are images of shows that are super popular in the UK. And I'd like for you to just put a number in the chat box of how many of these shows you can name. So I'll give you just a minute to use the chat. box and see if you can tell me how many of these shows you can name. Just type in a number.
Okay.
Zero. Nice. Good honesty there. Four. All right. Great. Unconfident. Three. One, two. Zero, two. One, maybe. Okay. Okay, so all right, so I'll start going through and naming them. Some of them you might know, but just, you know, from the picture, it might not have been quite enough to tell you. I will say, you know, any of these that are on, you know, Netflix, you're probably going to be more likely to be able to name, because, you know, that obviously is something that you can access easily. So this one up top here is called Skins. It's actually, I mean, it started as a British show, but it actually has become an American show too. It was popular probably like 10, 15 years ago, something like that. This is Sherlock. This might've been one that many of you recognize just because these two fellas are pretty popular over here by this point. This is Peep Show. It's a very British show. This is The Inbetweeners, also very British. This is The Crown, and this might have been one that you all recognize, or at least maybe have heard of, because it has gained a lot of popularity over here through Netflix. The Great British Baking Show. This is one of my all-time favorite shows to have on when I'm wrapping Christmas presents. It's just, there's something about it that's so calming to me. I think because they're all so nice to each other, and when you think about our reality TV shows, they're often kind of cutthroat and, you know, just really want to win. But, you know, you'll see some of these characters or some of the contestants helping each other out with finishing, you know, plating, whatever it is. And so I don't know, it's kind of fun. And then this is The British Office. So I'm sure we have some American Office fans in here. It did start off as a British show for anyone who doesn't know. And again, a very British show. So, you know, when I say very British, there's, you know, there's just something about certain TV shows that, and I think a lot of it comes down to the humor. The type of humor is very dry and it is not for everybody. So for any American Office fans out there, you know, if you think about Michael Scott, he is incredibly cringy, really hard to take. There's actually a word for it when you're watching it, and I can't remember exactly what it is, but there's a word for the feeling that you get when you watch somebody like that just messing up again and again and again, and it kind of makes you like cringe, you know. So if you think Michael Scott is cringy, David Brent from The British Office is like 10 times worse. And there's a lot of that in The Inbetweeners and in Peep Show as well. So you know, when I say it's very British, that's kind of what I mean. The humor is super dry and the shows can be incredibly cringy. So, you know, we'll talk about maybe some of these shows in the class, you know, if you can, you know, if you have the capability to watch any of these, you know, I would recommend that, especially some of them just kind of getting you into the mindset of what TV is like there and how, you know, I think some of these give you a really good picture of what it's like to grow up there, you know, especially The Inbetweeners. So we'll talk more about those shows kind of as we move through that HUM 180 class. All right, back to the trip. So next steps, applying on the Davidson Davie website to study abroad. I'll go to the website in a second, kind of walk you through what that looks like. Paying a $200 deposit to the business office. There's an application. So there's the main application. And then after you pay your deposit, there will be another form to complete. It's called the particulars form. Actually, I think we might've changed the name, but it's basically a form that asks you for additional details. Like, do you have any allergies? You know, do you have any things that would prevent you from being able to travel well, you know, all those kind of things. Then, you know, you have to sign a bunch of stuff in that form as well. Choosing a payment plan. So because we're talking about this trip so early, you actually have a really long time to break the payments up into small chunks. So if you wanted to do a monthly plan, it would be pretty manageable. And then watch for emails from us. So, you know, if you apply, then we will have that email, and that's how we'll communicate with you mostly. And then you'll need to register for the HUM 180 class. and then it's time to travel. So the only other thing that I kind of left off there was the study abroad application. I don't, that's actually not, I think, available yet for this particular trip, but that would be something too. If you're a student, we do have scholarships available to cover part of the cost of the trip. So you'd have to write an essay and you know, not super long or anything, but you do have to write an essay and apply for that. For more information, you can go to the website I'm about to show you, and you can also email us here. So I'll give you just a second if you want to, you know, take a picture of those email addresses or write them down or anything. I'll give you just a second to do that, and then I'm going to jump over to our website and show you how to get to the application. While I'm doing that, if anybody has questions, feel free to put them in the chat box, and I'll kind of address those maybe after I show you where the application is. All right, so our website, from the main page, you can go to Academics, International Education, Study Abroad. You can choose your location. So for all of you, hopefully it will be England. Gives you an overview of what you'll experience. The fee includes airfare, 7 nights of accommodation, all ground transport, daily continental breakfast, welcome and farewell dinners, some those walking tours I was talking about. We'll have a full-time guide on the ground with us who, you know, works in London and England and has all kinds of interest, knowledge about those areas, transfer to and from airports, and traveler's insurance. So basically what you're paying for is a few meals and souvenirs, and that's pretty much it. So again, it does include a lot, and you know, I think it's a really good deal for what you get. So if you go to, let's see, apply now. It'll take you to kind of instructions on how to, like, on all the steps for completing the application. You do have to read the study abroad policies and procedures first. And then after that, you can complete the study abroad application here. It's just a Google form. You can make your enrollment official by paying the business office a $200 deposit. I will say that we just talked through this kind of briefly. The $200 deposit is normally non-refundable, but because of all the kind of uncertainty around COVID, if you want to pay that, at least for now, that is going to be refundable. And we'll, I don't have like a date yet at this point that would that will be non-refundable again, but until you kind of hear it differently from us, that $200 fee is refundable. So the study abroad consent form is what I mentioned as the particulars form. So this is what's going to ask you a bunch of additional kind of personal information. Information about scholarships here. This trip is not eligible for the Gilman Scholarship. So if you're a student and you want to apply for scholarships for this trip, then it's going to, it'll be the internal Davidson-Davy scholarships. And again, that will be a partial scholarship. And then step 5, register for the HEM 180 course. All right, so stop and sharing here and see what kind of questions we have. Okay, so does anybody have any questions at this point? Anything that's on your mind? Any questions about the process, about the trip? So the HEM 180 course for this particular class is not going to be available for a while still. So it will meet January, it'll meet 5 times January right up through where we actually travel in March. And so, you know, I would say it's probably going to be on the schedule sometime in the fall 2021 semester. That would be my guess. So usually we create those courses in the fall. Technically, the schedule for fall 2021 and spring 2022 will be out, you know, in a few weeks. But I think probably that HUM 180 class for the England Study Abroad program is not going to be created for a little while after that. But if you are a traditional student at this point, you can talk to your advisor about that class and see if it will work in your program. See if it's something you can register for as a curriculum class that will get you a little closer to graduation, or if not, it's probably something you'll have to register for as a continuing education class. All right, I'm gonna ask you guys a question, and then if you don't have anything else for me, I'll let you go. Are any of you Harry Potter fans?
I am.
All right, cool. Well, you have plenty of time to read all the books and watch all the movies, and I don't necessarily expect you to do that, but
that's actually a plan of mine. I'm trying to do that. I know for sure I've read the first four, and I'm hoping I can read what, 5, 6, and 7?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. 7 books, right? Okay.
Yep. Yeah, they definitely right on that. They definitely take a turn after book 4. So, you know, I think it gets a little bit more adult at that point.
Yeah, the last movies were really dark.
Yep. And we'll definitely we will definitely talk about that because I think it's fascinating, especially having grown up with these characters. And, you know, as I got older, they got older and they started experiencing more adult-like things, you know, death and heartbreak and all those kind of things. It's very interesting to me. My nephew is 10 or 11. He's 11 now, and he's starting to read through them. And but you know, there's all kinds of spoilers at this point. So, you know, he kind of knows what's going on already, which is a little bit unfortunate. So if you haven't read them, hopefully you haven't gotten on the internet at all and haven't seen any spoilers of any kind. But yeah, we will. We'll definitely talk about the books and the movies and stuff. So if you do want to kind of be able to participate in those conversations, we won't be, you know, hopefully we'll be able to kind of make it interesting for everybody, but it'll definitely enhance the experience if you have some familiarity with those, with either the books or the movies, it's fine. Okay, well, great. Thanks so much everyone for coming. It's been fun. I love talking about this stuff. So if you have any questions, definitely let me know.
Thanks, Victoria. Sorry, I couldn't help you more today. I was doing the switch in between my class and over here. So
no, that's fine.
I'll try to help more next time.
No, it's fine. Thank you for coming.